Hopefully we've convinced you that you need to set up a GA4 property right now, or you already have an auto-created GA4 from Google, but if you watched our previous video in this series, you realize the setup is a total mess and you need to start from scratch and make sure that your data is tidy and understandable. Creating the GA4 property is the easy part. Let's walk through that. Here we are in the admin of Google Analytics, ready to create our GA4 property. If you're not on the screen, you're going to want to click on the link to the admin, which is at the bottom left-hand corner in both UA and GA4. Then on this screen, what we're going to click is Create Property. In this case, we're going to set up a property, let's say for example, for Kickpoint, the agency's website. So this will be kickpoint.ca. And typically we name our properties the same as the domain name that will be used for capturing data. You might want to name this the business name. Just make sure it's something that is easy for you to remember what it is that you named it so you can find it again later. You'll also want to change the reporting time zone and the currency that makes sense for you. Something to keep in mind, especially if you have an international business, that if a session crosses midnight, it will be considered a single session for reporting purposes, but you'll see two sessions counted, one on each day. So make sure to pick the right time zone. And if you do change the time zone later on, it does not retroactively change the data. So even though there's this really nice, you can edit these property details later message, just remember that you can, but you may not want to. Now we're going to click next. And then on this page, we actually didn't used to be required to select the industry category and business size. Now we are. So feel free to select what makes sense for you here. You know, maybe you want to give Google the truth, maybe you don't, and then click next. And in this case, now for business objectives, this is interesting. I find it really odd that they're going to change the reports you get based on what you select here. Personally, I would say pick get baseline reports. It gives you everything. And then if there's something you don't want to have later, we're going to show you how to remove that so you don't need to see what you don't want to see. But in this case, I like to get everything and then I can choose what I want to remove as opposed to Google giving me just a subset of the reports to start with. Then we're going to click create. Now, in this case, we finally get to setting up the web stream, which is what's called when you're collecting data from the site. Now, in this case, we're not looking at apps, we're just dealing with websites. So we're going to choose web for our platform. And then we're going to put in the website URL. Now, make sure to check if your website has a www or not, or something else. Make sure to enter that in correctly. And again, for the stream name, typically we paste in the domain name again so that you know exactly what it is that you're capturing. Now, before you click Create Stream, what we're going to do is click on this wheel right here for configuring enhanced measurement. Enhanced measurement is truly one of the greatest features in GA4. By default, GA4 captures all sorts of extra stuff that UA did not, at least not without some custom setup and some work in Google Tag Manager. Usually we turn off form interactions, which is right here, but in your case, you might want to leave that turned on for now. One of the dangers of form interactions is if you have the Facebook pixel on your website, the Facebook pixel technically sends data off to Facebook as a form submission. So you might see a lot of extra form submits, but if you're just testing at the beginning, then you can definitely leave this turned on and you can always shut it off later. So we're going to click save and then we're going to click create stream. Now we're given this screen and then immediately this other screen. You have a couple of choices here to install the Google tag. You can get installation instructions. So for example, they know that we use WordPress on the Kickpoint website, so it's giving us some different options. Or you can click install manually and it will give you the code that you would copy in and put directly on the website. Or you can choose another plugin, so it gives you different options for your different platforms here. So how you get it on the website is really going to depend on what you're using for your website builder. So for example, if we're using Squarespace, then they give us a bunch of different examples, copy your tag ID, and then setting up your Google tag integration with Squarespace. So just follow these steps. But if you know what you're doing and you just want to move right on past this, then just click back on the screen here and then you get the measurement ID. Now, the ID that you'll use on a website is this measurement ID here. You are not going to give them the stream ID here. This is not how data gets into GA4. This is how data gets into GA4. I see a lot of people making this mistake, so make sure to avoid that part. You're going to take this measurement ID and add it to your website, either based on the instructions that Google provided or what your website builder showed you, or maybe use Google Tag Manager and you're comfortable coding and can put the code on your website yourself. Once you've added the code to your website, what you're going to want to do at this point is open up an incognito session or another browser tab, and then you're going to go to the real-time view in GA4. I'll show you how to get there. We're going to close out of web stream details. We're just going to click next on the screen and say continue to home. You'll see no data is received from your website yet. If you do have anything showing up on your site already, you would click on reports, and then you can go into the real time. And if there was anyone coming to the website, we would start to see this show up right away. You wouldn't see any data in the reports just yet, but you would see stuff start to show up in the real-time view. Now, to actually see the data in GA4 itself, you're going to need to give it at least 24 hours, maybe 48 we've seen in some cases. In the meantime, we're going to set up some important stuff in the admin area. So we're going to go back to admin, which is here in the bottom left of the screen. And first thing we're going to do is go into the data settings section here in the admin. We're going to click on this, and then we're going to click on data collection. If you're using Google Ads, or if you want to collect demographic data in your website, you have to turn this on by clicking Get Started here. I recommend checking your privacy policy and making sure it doesn't need to be updated before you do this. To turn it on is quite simple. You click Get Started, you click Continue, you scroll down and say Activate, and then there you go. Now it's turned on. Next is data retention. Now, this is a bit of a misleading setting because people think it means that Google is ditching your data completely after 2 months. That isn't true. What they are doing is they're removing extra details on your events, what are called event parameters that are saved with events. It's important stuff. You want to have more than just 2 months of that. So definitely open up this dropdown, select this to 14 months instead, and then click Save. Now, if you'll be using this GA4 property in more than one domain, you're going to need to configure the cross-domain settings. That's how GA4 knows that it's okay that it's collecting data from two separate domains. And if someone moves from domain A to domain B, that they should carry that session through. Otherwise, it would just get lost in between. If you need to do that, we're going to hop back up to the data stream here, and then we're going to click on the stream, and then we're going to click on Configure Tag Settings, which is found down here. And then you're going to click on Configure Your Domains. In this case, we do have it set up for kickpoint.ca, but let's say, for example, we want to make sure that any domain that contains kickpoint.ca, so instead of just our main website, we want to make sure we're recording playbook, brand, anything else we might use. In this case, we're going to say any domain that contains kickpoint.ca is okay for cross-domain measurement. And then we're going to click Save. Make sure to set that up based on what makes sense for you and your own properties. Related to cross-domain measurement, you may also have some third-party sites like PayPal or payment gateways that you use if you're an e-commerce site, and you wouldn't want those to show up as referral sources. You may be familiar with that from UA. You can exclude those referrals here as well. You click Show All. I don't know why they don't show all the options right away. And then you'll click on List Unwanted Referrals, and then you'll say referral domain contains, let's say, for example, PayPal. So we'll put in paypal.com here and save. While you're here, you may also want to indicate any internal traffic as well, such as people on your office network. We're still in the same screen. We're going to click on Define Internal Traffic here. And then we're going to click on Create. We'll make sure to keep the traffic type values internal. I'll show you why in a moment. In this case, we'll say it's office IP, and then we're going to add in the office IP address. This is not the office IP address. I am just putting something in. For example purposes, if you're not sure what your IP is, you can Google what's my IP. Just remember that if you're at home, your IP address will probably change quite a bit. If you're at an office, it probably will change less often. Then, once we go back to this screen, now we have to decide what's going to happen with that excluded traffic. To do that, we're just going to click back a couple of times here. We're going to click here to get back there. I'm going to click back to get back here. And now we're going to go under data settings and then click on data filters. You'll see here there's one filter already called excluded internal traffic. It's added by default, and it's excluding anything where the traffic type parameter is internal. And you might remember just a moment ago that we saw that the traffic type parameter was internal when we set up that office IP address. If we scroll down a little bit, then we have an option for the filter state. The default is testing, or there's active, or there's inactive. I do recommend that you leave this filter state as testing until you're absolutely sure you're capturing internal traffic correctly, because once you set this to active, that data is gone. It cannot get it back. It is not like UA, where if you have a all website data view, it would go into that view, and then you have a filtered view, and then you could still see it in the all website data if you wanted to. It's just gone. It disappears. Keep that in mind. You might not want to set this as active right away. Just make sure you've got it set it up right before you start ditching your data entirely. The last thing you're going to want to do in the tag settings, you might want to adjust some of the basic timings in GA4. The session timeout, how long it takes when a user is inactive to when their session ends, and the engaged session timer, which is how long you want someone to be active for on the site before they count as an engaged session. To do that, we're going to click back into the screen here, and then we're going to go back up to the data streams. We're going to click on our stream again. Then we're going to scroll down and click on configure tag settings. Then we'll click show all, and then we're going to scroll down and pick adjust session timeout. You can change the defaults here. The default timeout is, as I said, 30 minutes. You can change it to whatever makes sense. The longest you can do for the session timeout is 7 hours and 55 minutes. Should you adjust the defaults? That's definitely a longer discussion. We'll make sure to have a video covering that in the future. For now, you might want to leave those alone unless you've already changed them in UA and GA4 to match. Now at this point, you're all set with your bare minimum GA4, and you can wait for that data to roll on in. If you don't care or need to learn about setting up conversions or custom dimensions and metrics, you can stop watching now. And that isn't me being snarky. Sometimes you just don't need that stuff set up, or you don't need me to explain it to you. You know what to do. Or maybe you're feeling overwhelmed. You want to come back to it later. Totally fair. If you keep watching, we'll get into those additional configuration options now. Still here? Great. Let's keep going. Let's get into some of the additional configuration options in GA4. You've probably heard that GA4 is all about events, but if you were used to using events in UA, you were used to how those were set up, where events had a category, action, and label. But if we go under engagement and then look at events here in GA4, you'll see that instead we'll have these event names, view promotion, view item list, page view, etc. If we click on an event name such as page view, and then we scroll down, what we're going to see are event parameters, page title, page location, page refer, and so on. Now, of course, we're seeing this here in the demo account, but when you go back to your own account and click on the page view event, you may not see these additional boxes. Why is that? That's because of custom dimensions and custom metrics. Custom dimensions and metrics did exist in UA, but they were used in very different ways, where you had to specifically set them up and then send data to them. In GA4, you can send whatever parameters you want along with an event, but if you actually want to see them in the GA4 interface, you need to register them as custom dimensions. To do that, we're going to go under the admin section, and then we're going to click on custom definitions. You can see here in the demo account, they have the page title, page location, etc., already registered as custom dimensions. Now we're going to flip back to our own GA4 that we just created, and then we're going to take a look at the custom dimensions, and we can see here that we haven't created anything yet. To add them, we're going to click on Create Custom Dimensions, and then we can select the event parameter, which in this case we haven't had any events come here yet, but when you open this up you'll see a list of the different event parameters, and then you can type in the dimension name. For example, we know that page location is going to be a parameter, and then we'll need to put in a display name for the dimension name. What we do is we make the dimension name that's shown in GA4 the same as the event parameter, just to keep it simple, but you can choose whatever naming scheme you want. And if you change something different, you might want to add a description just so you know exactly what it is that you're looking at. Then you would click save, and then it should show up in your GA4 reports within 24 hours. Let's take a look at conversions. All conversions are based on events. If you have, for example, the default form submit event, you would be able to have that as a conversion. Now, what if, let's say, for example, you wanted to have a page view as a conversion? You don't want to turn on every single page view as a conversion. You only need, say, your thank you page to be a conversion. To do that, we're going to click on Create Event over here. Now we can create an event that will be recorded when that specific page is viewed. We'll click on Create here, and then we're going to choose the custom event name. In this case, because it will be based on a page view, we're going to call it Page View Thanks, just to be really clear on exactly what's going on. And then we pick our matching conditions. We know that the event name is going to be page view, and then we're going to add another condition. We're going to say that the page location starts with, and then we'll choose https://kickpoint.ca/thanks, for example, as a thank you page. You, of course, will put in your own thank you page here. And then for the parameter configuration, we're going to choose to copy everything else from the source event. If you want to get advanced with it, you can change parameters, but right now we're just looking at the basics. We're not going to click this button here. And then we're going to click on Create. Now we've got this custom event that exists, and that will fire once someone actually gets to that thank you page. Oh, and of course, GA4 is helpfully telling us we will mark our event as a conversion. I'm going to close this, and then I'm going to go back over to conversions. Then you can see here, we don't have that event. It hasn't happened yet. What we're going to do is click New Conversion Event, and then we're going to add in the event that we just created. It will be Page View Thanks, and then click Save. Now when that event is recorded, you'll actually have it all ready to go as a conversion. And you can do this for any event at all. If you're just setting up GA4 and you don't have any form fields yet because you just added it 5 minutes ago to your website, let's add the conversion event of form submitted. We're going to type in form submit, but spelled correctly. And then we're going to click save. Once those form fills start happening, they'll already be set up as conversions. Couple last things that you should do while you're here. We're going to scroll on down to these links here. Google Ads links. If you have a Google Ads account, definitely link that up to your GA4 property. And of course, you should always link up Search Console as well to your GA4 property. To do both of these processes, you would click link and then follow the steps. Now at this point, you should have the basics of a GA4 property ready to go. Remember, it does take 24, sometimes 40 hours before you start to see data showing up, but you can always go to the real-time view and you get to that under reports and then click on real-time. It will show if your property is indeed capturing website data. Remember, in this case, we have not added this to a website, so we don't see any data showing up yet. But in your case, if you have added it to your website, you should start to see that show up. Once you have some data in your GA4, I'd next recommend watching our video on how to find your favorite UA reports in GA4. Do you still have more questions? Check out our other videos to get more answers and leave a comment letting us know what topics you want us to cover in future videos. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe.